Okay, good morning friends. So today we are going to study about structure of atom. Okay, so structure of atom, as the name suggests, in this chapter we are going to study about what is the structure of an atom, how the atom has been built, and what are the various subatomic particles we have. Okay, so the first of all, what is an atom, right? What is an atom? So atom is the word taken from a Greek word that is atomios. Okay, atomios, atomio, right? The meaning of this Greek word is indivisible. Indivisible, which means we cannot divide it further. Right. So the atom, the definition is what? The initial definition was what? It is the smallest particle which cannot divide further. Okay, that is the definition of atom. But this definition was proved to be wrong when various subatomic particles like electron, proton, neutron discovered. Okay, so that is why the definition of atom was wrong, because if it is a smallest particle, then how can other particles, like other subatomic particles like electron, proton, neutron, present within an atom? Okay, so that's the wrong definition we had initially. And the definition of atom is also given, if you see or if you study in NCERT, it is given that it is the smallest particle which takes part in a chemical reaction. Okay, so chemical reaction, when I am saying, we are not considering here redox reaction, we are considering here the reaction in which the atoms are involved. Okay, so atoms are also the smallest particle which takes part in the chemical reaction. Okay, so regarding atom, there was a scientist called John Dalton. He has given his own atomic theory, and that we call it as Dalton atomic theory. Okay, so what is Dalton atomic theory? What is the main point of Dalton atomic theory we have? That we'll see first. Okay, the first thing is, Dalton's atomic theory. Okay, the first point of this theory is what? All atoms or all matters in the universe, all matters in the universe are made up of very small particle called atoms. Okay, first point of Dalton's atomic theory. Second one, atoms can not be created or destroyed. Atoms cannot be created or destroyed. The properties of atoms of different elements are different, and for same elements are same. That's the third point we have, right? Suppose we have oxygen atom, so the property of oxygen atom will be different, and the property of nitrogen atom will be different. Okay, but all the atoms of oxygen will have the same property. Means what? Suppose you have to understand or you have to study about the property of oxygen molecule, right? Oxygen molecule. Then what we'll do, we'll read out or we'll study the property of oxygen atom, because oxygen molecule is made up of oxygen atom only, right? So whatever the property of oxygen atom, that will be the property of oxygen molecule, more or less. Okay, there won't be much change into that. Okay, so this is the theory of given by Dalton actually. Okay, so few points in this was wrong actually, like this one. Atoms cannot be created or destroyed. We can actually break an atom into smaller particles also, and this theory, this point was proved to be wrong when the various subatomic particles discovered. Okay, so the next point we are going to understand here is the discovery of subatomic particles. Okay, so first point, or the first subatomic particles we are going to study here, is electron. How the electrons are discovered. Okay, so the experiment for the discovery of electron, that we'll discuss here. Okay, discovery of electron we'll discuss in detail. Similar kind of experiment we have for the discovery of proton. Okay, so that we'll discuss. And the theory is given in any book, any physical chemistry book. If you see atomic structure, you can go through with that theory. You will understand, right? You can understand after watching this video. So for the discovery of electron, the experimental setup was something like this. This is the experimental setup for discovery of electron, and this experiment we call it as cathode ray experiment. Okay, so what happens into this? First of all, we have a discharge tube. This is, this cylindrical tube is, we call it as discharge tube. What is the discharge tube? It is a cylindrical glass tube which consists two electrode at the end, so this is the two electrode we have, discharge tube, cylindrical glass tube, and two electrodes at the end. Okay, so the electrode, and this electrode, it is connected with an external voltage supply, and the voltage we are using around 10,000 volt here, right? And this is the vacuum pump which we use to maintain very low pressure inside the discharge tube, which is 10 to the power minus 4 atmospheric in this order. Okay, so we have taken all the air present inside the discharge tube out with the help of vacuum pump, and we filled this discharge tube with any gas here. So we have some gaseous particles present here in the discharge tube. Okay, any gas you can take, that's not a constraint we have, any gas you can take. Okay, so now what happens in this, in this experiment, what happens when we apply a very high voltage source here, right? Then some invisible ray passes through, passes from this electrode towards the positive electrode, which is anode, right? And how do we know this? This is an invisible ray. Invisible ray from cathode to anode, it passes through. Okay, and how do we know that? Because this part was coated with a fluorescent screen, that is ZNS screen. This part was coated with ZNS screen. And when this light strikes at the surface, this part starts glowing, And that's how we know that when we apply an external voltage source here, an invisible ray from cathode travels towards anode. That ray we call it as cathode ray. Why cathode ray? Because it is coming out from cathode, or from this direction, from cathode to anode. That's why we are calling it as invisible ray. Okay, coming out from cathode. Now, since the cathode is negatively charged, right? So this ray was also considered to be, or assumed to be, negatively charged. Okay, how do we know this, that this ray is actually a charged, will have some charged particle or neutral, that when this ray passes through an electric or magnetic field, it get deflected. Okay, deflection proves that the ray is not neutral, it has either positive or negative charge with it. Okay, why negative only? Because it is moving towards the positive plate, or it is coming from the negative plate. That's why, first of all, since the deflection produced in the magnetic field, it means it is charged. What charge, positive or negative, that we understand by this experiment, since it is moving towards the positive plate, hence it is negatively charged. So cathode ray, this ray is cathode ray, invisible ray coming out from cathode, we call it as cathode ray. So cathode ray consists of negatively charged particle. Okay, cathode ray consists of negative charged particle called electrons. Cathode ray consists of negative charged particles called electrons. Okay, so that's how the discovery of electrons takes place. Okay, this experiment we call it as cathode ray experiment, and the whole setup we have discussed. Okay, right. Now the properties of cathode rays are what? It produces mechanical effect. Okay, mechanical effect means what? I'll tell you here. The first one, it produces mechanical effect. It produces mechanical effect. Mechanical effect means what? Suppose you have a blade, fan blade, suppose like this. This is the fan blade we have, suppose. And when you strikes with, you know, cathode ray on this blade, all these are cathode ray, suppose. When you strikes with the cathode ray, then the energy transfers to this fan blade and it starts rotating like this. This is mechanical effect, the transfer of energy. Why transfer of energy takes place? Because cathode ray consists of particles called electrons, right? An electron has its own mass, and since it is traveling, so we'll have some velocity over there. So the kinetic energy of electron gets transferred into the rotational energy of fan. Okay, that was the mechanical effect we have. Second point, cathode ray deflects in electric or magnetic field. Electric or magnetic field. Third point, it is negatively charged. Fourth one, the properties of cathode ray is same for all gases. Means whatever gas you are taking here, right, finally the electron only is coming out. Okay, so electron of hydrogen, electron of helium, electron of methane, all have the same properties. Okay, so electrons, properties of electron does not change with gases, right? That's why the properties of cathode ray, why cathode ray? Because it consists of electrons. Cathode ray is same for all gases. The fourth point is very important. Okay, these are the few properties of cathode ray. Now we have this understanding that atoms consist of negative charged particles called electrons. Now the atom as a whole is neutral in nature, that we know already, right? So atom as a whole is neutral, and if some negative charged particle is present within it, it means to neutralize this negative charged particle, we have some positive charged particle also present, should also present, right? So in this, by this theory only, we come to this conclusion that there must be a positive charged subatomic particles present within an atom, which makes the whole atom overall neutral, and hence it is stable. So in that way only we come to this part, that is the discovery of proton, which is a positive charged particle. Okay, so now for the discovery of protons also, we call it as anode ray experiment. Similar kind of experiment was done, okay, but we use here a perforated plate. Right, and what we observe in this, that when the cathode ray was coming out, I am not drawing the diagram again, just I am trying to make you understand with this diagram only, right? And it was observed that when cathode ray was coming out from this cathode, this side, in this way, at the same time some positive ray also, some invisible ray also travels towards the negative electrode, which is cathode. So at this time what we observe, some negative charge, some positive charge particles or positive ray also moves towards the negative charge electrode, right? This was assumed to be coming from the positive plate, which is anode, okay? And since it is coming from anode towards the negative plate cathode, we call it as anode ray, right? And anode ray coming from positive plate, it is positive charged, right? This also produce deflection in electric and magnetic field, since it is charged, right? So when we allow this ray to pass through electric or magnetic field, there is deflection in presence of electric and magnetic field, and this deflection is opposite to the deflection of cathode ray. Hence it is said to be that anode ray has oppositely charged, is then oppositely charged ray with respect to cathode ray, and it is assumed to be coming from anode, hence it is positively charged, right? So the particles of anode ray consists of particles called proton, which is a positively charged. All these points are same, right? It also produces some mechanical effect, deflects in electric and magnetic field. It is, instead of negatively charged, this one is positively charged. Properties of anode ray will be different for all gases. This is the very important difference we have. Properties of cathode ray is same for all gases. Whatever gas you take here, the properties will be same of cathode ray. But anode ray has different properties for different gases. Suppose you are taking hydrogen, right? So hydrogen, the proton is what? H plus one electron. So this is the proton we have here, right? Similarly, the positive charge species in case of helium is what? When you take helium gas, that will be He plus. So H plus and He plus are two different cations, right? Two different positive charge ions, right? That's why the properties of anode ray is different for different gases. This is the major difference we have in the two rays, cathode rays and anode rays. Okay, so I hope you have understood this experiment, which is not that much, you know, important, but to understand the, you know, experiment and discovery, you should know this. Okay, so you can go through the theory given in NCERT, you will understand the experiment exactly. Okay, the next thing is, with the help of proton and electron, when we try to find out the atomic mass of different atoms, the atomic mass was not coming out to be correct for all the atoms. Okay, then we started thinking about the third type of subatomic particles present within an atom, which must be neutral in nature. Okay, and that third type is neutron. Okay, for discovery of neutron, the beryllium the beryllium atom is attacked by alpha particle. Beryllium atom is bombarded with alpha particle, that is helium, and then it converts into carbon, and then we'll get one neutral element which is neutron. So this one is neutron, which is neutral in nature. There is no charge present on this neutron. We have only two charged subatomic particles, that is electron and proton, and this one is neutron. This reaction is actually nuclear reaction. Nuclear reaction, where nucleus are involved actually. You must have thinking about that, how this helium and beryllium converts into carbon. So when the nucleus are involved, this kind of change is possible. So nuclear chemistry is not in our syllabus, but this is one type of nuclear reaction. Okay, so this is one thing. Now since the neutron is neutral in nature, so this produces no deflection in electric or magnetic field. Okay, so when you allow this ray or this neutron to pass through an electric or magnetic field, we don't observe any deflection because it is neutral in nature. Deflection is only possible when the particles are will have any kind of charge, whether it is positive or negative charge. Okay, now so this is a three subatomic particles. We have various other subatomic particles present, like meson, positron, neutron, neutrino, etc. All these are subatomic particles we have, but mainly we have three, that is electron, proton and neutron, and that we have discussed. Okay, now the charge and mass of this subatomic particles you have to keep in mind. Okay, so like for example, we have electron. So the charge on electron is -1.6 into 10 to the power minus 19 coulomb. Mass of electron is 9.1 into 10 to the power minus 31 kg. Okay, similarly we have proton. Charge on proton, it is equal to that of electron, but sign is positive, magnitude is same. Mass of proton is 1.67 into 10 to the power minus 27 kg. Okay, the third one is neutron. Neutron, the charge on neutron, as we have discussed, it is zero, and the mass on neutron is equals to the mass of proton, which is 1.67 into 10 to the power minus 27 kg. This is the charge and mass we have. Sometimes you have to, they ask this question also, the charge and mass ratio of electron, proton and neutron. Okay, they'll find you the order. So when you know these two values, you can find out charge and mass ratio. Okay, that we also call it as specific charge. Okay, so with this value you can easily find out. Okay, so now till now we have discussed about the various subatomic particles, the discovery of various subatomic particles. Now the next objective the task we have, that how this subatomic particles are arranged within an atom. Okay, so the arrangement of subatomic particles within an atom, that we are going to understand now, right? So for that, different scientists, various other scientists have given their models, their theory about how the subatomic particles are arranged within an atom. Okay, so this theory of arrangement of subatomic particles within an atom, we call it as atomic models. Okay, so next we are going to understand what are the different atomic models we have, what are the drawback, why we have discarded some of the atomic models, what atomic models we are following now. Okay, so all these things we are going to discussed in the next, we're going to discuss in the next session. Okay, thank you.